Right. So the governance or government system, the governance or government system is a model which actually centralizes the power and that delivers the goods and services. So if X is a citizen of India, he have all the fundamental rights, he have all the rights in the world, but if these systems fail to deliver to Mr. X, then there is no point in having all these systems. Again, I'm taking present pandemic. I'm taking the present pandemic as a benchmark, right? So people are waiting in line at the hospitals, or even in death, there is no dignity. So whom should we blame? Should we blame in the first place, or should we learn? And why is this important to our ethical discussion or ethics in governance discussion? Now, just think about it. Earlier, what used to happen? Earlier, we used to have tribal hamlets, right? So there are 8 to 10 houses in a particular hamlet, or if expanded, it is called as a village. They used to govern themselves, right? According to their needs and requirements, they used to govern themselves. But after this, we moved on to agrarian societies. Agrarian societies became civilizations. Civilization became kingdoms. Kingdoms become societies, like larger civilizations as we see today. So India is a civilization, huge, 1.3 billion population. So 1.3 billion population is not a homogeneous group. Each and every region have its own areas. For example, probably people in Northeast or in the tribal hamlets of some remote area are actually happy today because they are cut off from the larger masses. And people who are happy till now with urbanization are the ones who are suffering the most. So staying in Bengaluru, Hyderabad, Delhi is more dangerous right now rather than in staying in some remote area of Arunachal Pradesh. Right? Do things change stay the same? Earlier, what was celebrated is now a problematic issue. What is problematic issue is now celebrated. So all these things boil down to one thing, right? That the term governance. Now, so these are systems. So whenever you hear the term system has collapsed. Recently, Delhi High Court has also mentioned your system failed. So what is system? So for simple analogy, or for lack of better analogy at this point of time, system can be like pipelines, right? So systems are like pipelines, but what flows in the pipeline is more important, right? So good intentions should flow along with the good systems. That is what makes good governance. So systems can be many things, but ultimately without ethics in the systems or without values in the system, everything will fail. Okay, without values, everything will fail. If you understand this one particular line, right, then whatever comes next is easy. Right. Now, yesterday I have shared the same PDF. So we see a previous question, right? What do you understand by the term governance, good governance, and ethical governance? Now, for a minute, you can think, right? Governance, whatever I have told you is technically governance. The system that is either central government, state government, or local self-government delivering governance or delivering or implementing policies, schemes, rules and regulations, and all these things is technically governance. Now, what is good about it? So per se, governance is a bad thing. So if we have something called as good governance, do we also have something called as bad governance? So what comes under or what is classified as bad governance is one question to ponder upon. Right now, it's a perspective. Okay, fine. So it's easy to define what is good governance and what is governance. Now, the most difficult part becomes what is ethical governance? Right. So what is ethical governance? Lack of transparency, corruption, accountability, and all these things is called as bad governance. So absence of them also leads to bad governance. So what is ethical governance? That is the tricky part, right? Remember, good governance can be morally about legal sense and moral sense, but what about ethical governance? So all ethical things are not legal things. That is what we have established, right? So that is a question for you to think upon. We will discuss. Next, there is a heavy ethical responsibility on the public servants because they occupy position of power, handle huge amount of public funds, and their decisions have wide-ranging impact on society and environment. What steps have you taken to improve your ethical competence to handle such responsibility? See, he's assuming that you are a potential bureaucrat, right? So he's asking you a direct question. What are the steps that you have taken to improve your ethical competence and handle such responsibility? So the first and foremost thing is we are reading. Ethics for UPSC. At least because of this, we will be sensitized. We will develop more common sense. We will see things in a different perspective. We will be more empathetical, sympathetical, right? We will develop more compassion. We will develop understanding, right? So we will also break the stereotypes. So you break. You develop a lot of sensitivity towards all these things just by reading these particular things. For example, last 70 years of India, we did not invest in the healthcare system. And it is biting us very badly in this present scenario. So the most common and easy to go answer is even developed countries like Italy and America has faced the similar scenarios, right? So there is no argument in that empirical data. Every developed country also has faced a lot of problem because of COVID pandemic. But the thing is, in comparison to the size of our population, do we even have the adequate beds that we need to have? Okay, the clear answer is no. In spite of that, people will die? Definitely yes. But do we have enough infrastructure? Definitely no. So some lives could have been saved between these two no's. Definitely yes and definitely no. So that is bad governance. And 70 years, thousands of MLAs, thousands of MPs, hundreds of governments have changed different states. So we cannot blame any one person, but blame the entire system. So that is where governance is more like a framework, and that framework without values, that framework without compassion is not going to help you. For example, the Haryana chief minister, I think yesterday made a statement, okay, the dead are not going to come back and talk, right? So counting the dead won't matter right now. Okay, so that somewhere shows lack of sensitivity. I think yesterday or today's newspaper, Karnataka minister said to some farmer, you can die happily, right? So being in a position where you develop, where you deliver governance as a politician or as a bureaucrat, both these people should have all these traits. When these people actually miss all the traits, then there is never a concept of ethical governance, right? Now, the easy to go criticisms, like we should have invested here, we should have invested there. It's in the hindsight, everybody is like 20 by 20, right? Britain prime minister, let people die, let the bodies pile up, but I won't impose lockdown. See, again, that is one more ethical dilemma. He has to take a decision for, but again, compassion is what makes people humane, right? So what are the steps you have taken to improve? So if you are not preparing for UPSC, or if you even don't know there is something called as ethics, compassion, and all these things, maybe you will be brainwashed by which media outlet you see, whether you are seeing the pro-government one or the opposite government one. If you see the opposite government one, it's very bad, it's gloomy. If you see the pro-government one, everything is fine, government is doing fantastically, people are not dying, just people are on the roads. So actually the truth is in between. People are dying. At the same time, situation is not as bad as it seems. And it's a very difficult parameter to say what is an okay situation. Who is a winner here? Right? So if you take highest ethical standards, even death of one person is a failure of the system. So around 2 lakh people have died in India. And even the death, there is no dignity. So somewhere as a society, as a whole, we need to introspect. It's not only about governance. So why am I dragging society as a whole? Because society was complacent in the corruption. Society was complacent in the bureaucratic lethargy. Society did not ask the government in the last 70 years, where are my beds? Now the society is asking, where are my oxygen tanks? Till 6 months ago, show me one media outlet or one public intellectual talking or asking any government anywhere in the country, like, where are the oxygen tankers? Right? Did anyone plan, like, if X village is affected with COVID and if they need oxygen cylinders, where are my oxygen cylinders? Did any one single person think that? Right? So that is where the value system or the ethical governance come into the picture. Okay? So it's not a crime not to think of everything. X is a village. There are 6 lakh villages in India. I cannot think about all the 6 lakh villages, right? Somebody has to be responsible about X village, Y village, and that person should have the capacity. So let's say X village is under panchayati or a local self-government. They have to ask the state. State has to ask the center. So if you have compassion at the top, at any one level, central, state, or local self-government, then only funds will flow to the XY village, right? So without values, pipelines don't work. Just because you have a good pipeline, that doesn't mean it will automatically deliver governance. I hope you are recognizing the difference between mechanical pipelines and ethical pipelines. So what is the correlation between good governance and ethical governance? Which one flow into the other? Ethical governance is like a base, the pizza base, right? That will lead to everything. See, if you have compassion right now today, that you don't want people to go out of their homes, what will you do? You will say you can file all your data or anything online. You don't have to come to say something. Or for example, you can impose lockdown, but you will be more humane about it. Like you will announce it 24 hours before or 48 hours before, something like that. Right. So that is also good governance, right? You are giving an opportunity for the people to stock certain basic necessities or for the migrants to move. So compassion flows. So again, blind spots might be there. I'm not saying, you know, I can think of everything. I still can hurt someone. But by having more humane approach, by compassionate value-based ethical governance, I will think, who is this going to affect? Then what are the steps that I can take off, think of? All right. See, again, it's a very, very simple analogy. Thousand times, even if you say the same thing, it's still the same, right? X is a government or an individual or a bureaucrat or a politician. Okay. He is by default not honest. Okay. Or by virtue of his job, he has a lot of discretionary power. He sees a lot of good things like money, power, opportunities, things that most common men cannot even think of. So when you are in thick of all these things, it's very difficult to be honest, right? So that is why we create something called as frameworks. What are frameworks? Example, citizen charters, right to information act, social audits, right? Public service delivery bill, code of ethics, code of conduct, judicial scrutiny, CAG audit, internal audit, yes, performance review, CVC, CBI, Lokpal, Lokayukta, Supreme Court, public perception. So these all are frameworks to keep you honest. Yes. So the framework will put a lot of fear in you. Media. For example, if you're an officer taking bribe, somebody can shoot that video and leak it to the media. You will be in a lot of problem. So these frameworks put X in a bind. X can be a politician. X can be a bureaucrat. Bureaucrat are of various levels, right? All India Services, Group A, B, C, D, right? So politician and bureaucrat. Now, when you have all these mechanisms, they're keeping you honest. But at the end of the day, if X is not having virtues, values, okay, these things, the entire framework things are not going to work. CAG is there. CAG has blamed state governments like thousands of times. It has criticized almost all the governments. In spite of all this, India has one of the most highest criminalization of politics. In corruption perception index, we rank 86. Right? We even have technology, right? Public service delivery, direct benefit transfers. So why do you think this is a huge list, right? This is like such a huge list. In spite of all this huge list, why are we doing so badly in politics or in corruption perception index? And according to corruption perception index and other surveys, Indian bureaucracy is considered as the worst or most inefficient bureaucracy in entire Asia. This is not something new. So on the right hand side, we have frameworks. On the left hand side, we have empirical data, which shows our bureaucracy is not working fantastically. And thanks to COVID and other pandemics, we are actually seeing that there are actually a lot of problems. When you don't speak up of corruption in the normal times, during war times, it is going to come back and bite us very, very heavily. Right? So it's very evident, right? Without virtues and values, all the frameworks, all the rules in the world are not going to deliver you good governance. So ethical governance or ethical perspective or ethical people manning the governance posts are prerequisite for good governance. Clear? See, tomorrow we will start probity in governance. So these are the same things you see, right? Code of ethics, code of conduct, charter act, citizen charter, right to information act. So what is the need of all those things? Because just because you have virtues that also is not going to make you things automatically good, right? You need frameworks to protect the honest bureaucrat. So as the second ARC report says, you need frameworks for the honest to be honest and the dishonest to be scared. So frameworks make the dishonest very scared. Thanks to RTA Act, 2G scam came out. Right? So in the same way, different examples. Are we clear? Any questions? And remember, don't make the mistake of assuming only ethics will deliver good governance. Only ethics is useless. At the same time, only frameworks are useless when there is a synergy between ethics and frameworks. When there is a lot of overlap between these two things, that is when things start working fantastically. And frameworks also come out of ethical values, right? Frameworks also come out of ethical values, the moral values, right? Examples to mention for good all the traits. Whenever you see a compassionate thing being done by some politician or some IAS officer, all those things are ethical governance. Right. We will discuss about good governance, then we will go on to ethical governance. So this is the same principle, the same document I have shared yesterday. So the most important things in the document is code of ethics, and the one more is public service delivery bill. For example, see, this one is framework. Say, for example, this one promotes ethical governance, protecting the interest of the poor, underprivileged, and weaker sections. This one reinforces the ethical standards. See, that is why we have the constitution, right? To protect the weaker sections. First of all, we will see the definition of good governance, then we will go on to the ethical governance. It will be easy. So I assume most of you have read this particular PDF. It's not something new. When we have read about Nolan Committee report, when we have seen about public service deliveries, same principles. Now, we will see what is good governance, then we will understand ethical governance and the interlinking of the two. First of all, the concept of good governance is not new. So, from Janapadas, from Mahabharata to Ramayana, we have ethical standards set to us or given to us in various historical, mythological, and epics, right? India always had this concept of dharma. Dharma is the closest thing that we can call as ethics. There is no equivalent term to dharma in anywhere in the world, right? So dharma can be many things. So dharma is manifestation of good governance. Good governance is manifestation of dharma. So what is dharma? Dharma is different thing to different people. For example, to a king, in the happiness of his subjects lies his happiness. So a king's dharma or a raja dharma is what? To keep his subjects happy. As long as they are happy, he is happy. Their welfare is his welfare. Whatever pleases himself, he does not consider as good. But whatever pleases his subjects is considered as good. Okay, so this was mentioned 2500 years ago. Okay. In continuation of the same, Ambedkar, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar warned us, blind faith. So today we are in a society where we think the king knows what is good for all. And what is, I asked you, right? It is because of God said something is good, that is why we follow it. Or we follow something because it is good and that is why God has recommended that. In the same way, in the modern day society, because of the large scale of governments throughout the world, people started thinking everything that the government is doing is the right thing for the society. But that is not the case. There are vested interests, I told you. A politician will think for vote maximization. A private hospital will think for profit maximization. It's not a crime. Thinking about vote maximization or profit maximization is not a crime, but not at the cost of governance or institutions. For example, yes, definitely Ramaraja, Suraj, that is the next line, right? Suraj here. Ramaraja, Suraj. Mahatma Gandhi has propounded Ramaraja or Suraj, the self-governance, right? Good governance. Suraj is good governance. Swaraj is self-governance. So that is one thing. Ramaraja is good governance. Now, not at the for example, recently the Madras High Court criticized that the Election Commission of India for conducting elections and not imposing serious restrictions on the political parties for political campaignings. And the Election Commission responded to the court saying it is the responsibility of the state governments to implement the law and order. So we have two constitutional bodies. One is the Madras High Court. The other one is Election Commission of India. So Madras High Court criticized Election Commission of India for not having common sense, not having empathy and sympathy, which is ethical governance. And Madras High Court is blaming whom? Election Commission is blaming state governments. Why? Law and order is the duty of the state. So what has happened? So let's assume the system is criticizing one more system, that system is criticizing one more system, but nobody is actually bothered about the reason for all these systems exist. What is the reason for all these systems existence? The very reason that why we have systems is now ignored, welfare of the people, but the implementation of the rules and regulations has become more important. So the bureaucracy is technically saying instrument has become institutions. And nobody is giving a problem. So this is where we can see clear violation of values. For me, my votes are important. That is a politician statement. He is not wrong. Election Commission is saying, for me, it's important to conduct the elections. And probably to please the political masters also. Again, this we cannot officially say, but the thing is that might be one reason, influence of the political masters. So High Court has come out late, very late. So what was High Court doing when the entire rally was happening? So in the hindsight, High Court has woke up. Right? So what about the state governments? Law and order has to be implemented. But again, for me, vote maximization was important. So in all these things, nobody was actually worried about the last man in the line. Now, again, today's newspaper, if you see, the poorest are the worst hit. See, you don't see Ambani or me or you going to a political rally, right? The privileged or the well-off or even the decent doing are more or less avoiding the political campaigns, being smart, wearing double mask and all these things. But it is the poorest who attend these political rallies, either for money or just for the sake of entertainment because of lack of education. Right? And again, they are the ones who are going to pay the heavy price for pandemic. Are we clear? So ethical governance in a different perspective from today's world. Now, again, we cannot blame any one person, any one party or anything. The entire system has become lethargic for decades. So we cannot change it overnight. Now, second ARC report has given 8 attributes for good governance. So you have to mug it up. Please mug it up. Whenever you write GS paper to answer writing or anything related to good governance, these 8 terms are expected from you. So this is directly from second ARC report given in 2005. And one more thing, please remember, in 2005, the ethics paper were not there. So the definition for good governance is very simple. So you need to be accountable. You need to be transparent, obvious. So for example, what are the various mechanisms available for accountability, transparency? You have to be responsive. Whenever there is a crisis, you need to react immediately. Right? You need to participate in consensus oriented, follow the rule of law, effective and efficient, and equitable and inclusive. So these are the same things we can see in the above code of ethics or code of conduct or public service delivery bill. Nothing new. But in 2020, government has introduced good governance index. Right? It is much broader and it covers a lot of sectors. This is core principles. These are the sectors. Don't be confused between the two. So in agriculture and allied activity also, you can be responsive, accountable, transparent, and equitable and inclusive. The same applies to environment and so on and so forth. So these are the sectors that government is taking as the parameters. Right? No. So on an individual level, what is expected of a different parameters? Let's see. So according to Government of India, in agriculture and allied sectors, let's say you are increasing the milk production, you are doing good governance, or you are promoting good governance, or you are promoting Swarajya. Right? You get the basic idea. So we don't have to discuss line by line, but you get the macro picture. In commerce and industry, ease of doing business. What will happen if ease of doing business is there? More companies will come and set up shop. Foreign direct investments will be attracted. Economy will grow. Economy, when it grows, will spill over into other sectors of the society. So according to government, doing anything for good governance, anything for ease of doing business is good governance. Right? So everything, like each and every sector, has its own requirements. For example, gender parity is good governance. Quality of education automatically leads to human capital. But doesn't this again promote working in silos? Okay. So see, these are parameters. Convergence is happening in a whole different level. For example, Poshan Abhiyan is there. When you work on nutrition, you are also working on infant mortality rate and maternal mortality rate. And combinedly, we are working together for gender empowerment. So one thing will spill over into another thing, right? See. So these are tools. So who is using the tool efficiently to converge is good governance, and that comes to ethical governance, right? For example, I will ask you this. Let's take an hypothetical example. Shadow pandemic is something that World Health, I think UN has announced, right? There is a huge shadow pandemic. Yesterday also there is an article in Indian Express which argues that among all these things, shadow pandemic or violence towards women or gender parity is increasing, right? Women are the worst victims of this entire pandemic scenario, both externally and in domestic sense, right? Have we seen any scheme or any solution being offered in that dimension? Did you see the Supreme Court saying something about it? Tomorrow, let's say there is a newspaper article which says a woman has been killed by her in-laws or by husband or due to domestic violence, these many people has died. Then the media will start picking up saying, you know, women, the shadow pandemic is happening. Nobody was worried. The policymakers were sleeping, etc., etc. But did the Supreme Court or the High Court of any state has taken a proactive step in saying, did you establish a helpline or are you following up on the helplines? Right, the system is stretched too thin. The police officials are already burdened with maintaining the law and order, night curfews, etc. At the same time, you're also asking them to take care of the domestic violence cases. So where do we fit all these things? Are we being responsive? Are we setting up, you know, something like Zoom sessions or online courts so that, you know, if someone is getting abused, immediate relief is provided to them? Right, so that is where ethical governance flows. Right, you have seen something in the newspaper and you imagine how bad the problem is, and you are taking proactive steps, like a chief minister of a particular state is coming and saying, you know, this is what is happening in the society, please don't do this, this is not the time. I mean, it's not like you can do it later. I mean, you have to be sensitized, you have to get better. If anybody is actually facing a problem, immediately call to the police centers. A dedicated line has been established. So that is good governance, which flows from ethical governance. Does that make sense? See, I will tell you one more example. Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. So see, behavioral change is the biggest hurdle of Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. This much we have established. And there are world famous thinkers like Daniel Kahneman and many, many Indian experts also have suggested nudging effect, N-U-D-G-E, nudge, right? So nudge as a component for behavioral change. So Swachh Bharat was introduced around in 2014, I guess. So, but if you remember during the pandemic wave one, ethical governance is proactive or reactive? It can be both, right? It should be proactive technically. It should also be reactive. See, they are not one and the same. See, governance, understand, is you acting on something. System acting on something is governance. If you are doing something before it happens, that is proactive. If you are doing something after it has happened, is reactive. But this why is ethical? It's simple. System has a rule, that is good governance. Okay, but that rule can also be ethical also. Right? So ethical governance is both proactive and reactive. See, immediately you have seen something, you are reacting, right? Oxygen cylinders are not there. So you immediately dialed all your friends all over the world. That shows you have some compassion and empathy. You don't want people to die. So you're pooling all your resources instead of sitting. So what does that tell you? You have reactive. So just now I have received a Telegram message which reads, you know, India has rejected UN help. Why? We have a robust system. India declines UN offer for assistance for COVID crisis, says it has a robust system. So what does that statement tell you? Are we worried about the PR image? Are we too egoistic to accept the help? Or do we need every help that we can think of? Right? So that flows from the value system. Okay. So are we clear so far? See, the woman example I have given you, the gender violence is proactive. If you do something about it, it's proactive. Okay, or at least being responsive, not even proactive. It's more about responsive. Reactive is something that which you do in relation to some things that are happening. See, among all these things, TB vaccination, are we as a country discussing about TB vaccination? But somewhere some bureaucrat has been given a responsibility to eradicate tuberculosis from India. So if that bureaucrat is not wavering from his duty and he is given all the support in the world by the government in spite of the COVID crisis, then that is fantastic good governance. Just because we are having COVID, that doesn't mean we can ignore tuberculosis, right? Because every year around 16 lakh people die of tuberculosis. COVID has so far managed to kill 2 lakh people, right? Yes. And, you know, as a country, we survived the COVID, but our economy has collapsed. Unemployment has reached all-time high. Then that is also a problem. So that is also an area where the government has to focus on, right? So you can imagine the problems of the state, right? It has 10,000 things to deal with and it cannot think of everything. That is where the role of politicians and bureaucrats as an ethical moral agents increases, right? If everybody is doing their job fantastically, probably we wouldn't have been in this particular scenario, right? So these are the parameters that government uses to measure good governance. For example, climate change and change in forest cover, that also has to be maintained. Now, again, this is from second ARC report. There are 4 pillars on which good governance survives. What are the 4 pillars? You need to have ethos, ethics, equity, and efficiency. See, it's like repetition of the same principles in a different language, right? So what is the first ethos of a good governance? Ethics, ethos, the value system is welfare maximization. That is your mantra. It's a good question, Manugna. So what Manugna is asking is, are only politicians and bureaucrats are the part of the system? Citizen, politician, bureaucrat, markets, civil society. So all these people are stakeholders in the good governance business. It's your right to ask the government to get the services, right? So if citizen is sleeping, it will give a lot of leverage to the politician and the bureaucrat and the market, right? If the citizen is not active in the form of civil society, then there won't be any accountable mechanisms, right? So for good governance to be delivered, all these players are equally important. For example, Association for Democratic Reforms, that is a civil society organization, which forced the judiciary, right? Which forced the judiciary to ask the politicians to be more transparent and honest. So all the systems, the legislature, executive, and judiciary, the 3 pillars which derive the power from the constitution are part of the good governance systems. So that is why in the report, second ARC report, I have shared the 4th ARC report, there is a code of ethics for judiciary also, right? So judiciary, civil society forced the judiciary to act upon politicians, and it's a feedback mechanism to the civil society that we can be more proactive. So that creates an environment or ecosystem of good governance. So welfare maximization, and you should do it honestly, transparently, and with integrity. Next is equity, treating all the citizens equally. And last one is efficiency, right? We know we have limited resources. Resources are limited, wants are unlimited. So how do we balance these resources and wants is the biggest problem of governance. Now, we will see a definition of good governance or governance by the 10th five-year plan. Okay. This actually gives a lot of meaning to all our discussion in a logical way. That is something you can quote in your answer writing also, right? Good governance refers to management of all such processes. We have seen above processes, right? Police is one, environment. There are 10,000 processes in the system. In any society, that in the society defines the environment which permits. This is the single biggest important thing. What? It should permit and enable individuals to raise their capabilities on the one hand. So I should be my best version. On the other hand, provide opportunities to realize their potential. This is what Amartya Sen's capability approach says. You are allowing me to get educated. At the same time, you are promoting an ecosystem where jobs are available. So what is the point of providing world-class education without jobs? And enlarge the set of available choices. So good governance creates a system where individual is the best version of himself. At the same time, he gets to explore his best version. Multiple options A, B, C, D, E are available. These processes covering political, social, and economic aspects of the life impact every level of human enterprise, be it individual, household, village, region, or the nation. Now, who is responsible? So, it is the responsibility of the state to create that kind of ecosystem. Individual capabilities and encouraging private initiatives. So that is what good governance is all about. Now you can understand the reason for including ease of doing business, right? Ease of doing business. Why government has to worry about air pollution, or why government has to worry about land acquisition? So all these things fit together to create an ecosystem. As long as ecosystems are there, it will lead to the development of the state. It's a very simple and straightforward definition, right? But application of that definition is very important because it's not that easy. Think about it. Are we providing health? We can ask a simple test. Digital education. Due to pandemic, schools and colleges are shut down. Digital education is there. So what are the things that government has done? Government has created TV channels. Government has created YouTube channels. Okay. It is allowing the schools to get people educated. On the other hand, what did government fail to do? Or what did government fail to create an ecosystem? For example, broadband. Broadband is not available to every citizen. 4G connections are not available to all the citizens. Devices are not available to all the citizens. On the one hand, you are providing opportunities. On the other hand, you are not providing resources. So, sir, why should state be involved? So, again, here, state should create an environment. this environment to, for the 4G to flourish should have been created earlier. It is not. But what is the lesson? We should work on it now. So again, it is the same state which even created this reliance. Just think about India in 2016 without reliance, where 1 GB of internet is like 250 rupees and everybody is locked down in their homes. You know, there will be literally civil unrest. Thanks to OTTs, thanks to broadband, Wi-Fi, 4Gs and smartphones. Okay, nobody is complaining. Right now, everybody is happily spending their time on chatting, etc. But if really there was no internet, there was no Jio, there was no cheap internet connections, I don't think, you know, people could have stayed in their homes for this long. It would have been a, you know, much worse scenario, right? So the same applies to health and so on and so forth. You can think of all the things, right? So the test of the cake lies in eating, right? And in the same way, the application or the validity of good governance lies in So in 2011, when I read Hindu newspaper, there was a line which says, according to World Health Organization, the ratio of doctors to patients is very less in India. Okay, so that is an omission that has been continued by successive governments and each and every state also. Nobody actually invested the time and energy in improving this ratio. In 2021, we are paying the price for the same. So that omission is also a failure of governance. So should government create doctors? No, but government should create capabilities and encourage the private initiatives. Make things as easy as possible. Right? And it has to be done on priority basis. When you fail to prioritize things like human capital development, knowing very well that is exactly what China has done. So what happened? Human capital development did not happen, and that is coming to hurt us. Clear? So see I'm trying to bring current contemporary examples in involving everybody in the system, right? The judiciary did not help. The media did not help. So no, but media is also like 2 day circus, right? If something is in the news, they will be like, okay, 2 days, everybody will talk about it. And the third day, they will move on to something else. We don't have a priority base. No. Last one page, I guess. Okay. So what are the barriers to good governance? Again, from second ARC. Again, please don't blame the bureaucrats outrightly. All right. So, indifferent attitude of the public servants, lack of accountability, red tapeism, low level of awareness, ineffective implementation of laws and rules. So, on prima facie, if you read all these lines, it's like the bureaucrat has to be blamed in its entirety. But again, bureaucrat, politician, judiciary, civil society, citizens, and the media. All the players have created this kind of system. For example, indifferent attitude of the public servant. So you are an IAS in a particular district right now, pandemic is all-time high. There are no oxygen cylinders. There are no doctors. So as a district collector, can you create doctors out of thin air or bring oxygen? No, right? So after a point of time, after trying everything, I will reach that stage of helplessness where I can literally add zero value to the system because it is beyond and above my capacities and I have given my best. So If I see that in everyday basis, like literally each and every day, if I see the same thing, don't you think I will also develop that indifferent attitude? right? It should not be an excuse. I'm not saying it should become a habit, but at the same time, the ability to try in the first place should not be killed because of lack of support from the system. So again, it's the government's responsibility to create that ecosystem for the public servants to do their best. Allow creative ideas. For example, let's say a bureaucrat came to an MP and suggested something, sir, we should develop a oxygen plant for future pandemics also, it will be helpful. If the MP says no, then what can the IAS officer do? But if the MP is proactive, then probably yes. Again, the MP alone cannot do much, right? He needs to get the government support. So everything is interlinked. Lack of accountability. Again, this is written in 2005. Just that year only RTI was introduced. So from there onwards, a lot of things have happened, right? Lokpal, Lokayukta, CVC has been empowered. Social audits have been introduced. Right to Information Act is introduced. So a lot of tools have been developed. Even now, public service delivery bills are being planned. So when all these things come, accountability will be increased. Red tapeism. Now, why do red tapeism exist? Red tapeism means bureaucracy binding itself in rules and regulations and not being helpful to the public. So red tapeism is a negative connotation where it says red tapeism is like a slow, it's an opaque mirror where nothing is clear. So the solution to all this is public service delivery, citizen charters, right? Direct benefit transfers. And the most important thing is technology. E-governance or electronic governance is a break to the red tapeism because everything will be digitized. Let's say I filed an RTI online. Okay, automatically I will know where that particular file is on which particular day. Earlier it was an opaque system. Right now I know my file is at a joint secretary level or a secretary level or at a different department level. So is single window clear? Single window clearance, right? Low levels of awareness and implementation of the laws and rules. So what strategies or what are the tools that are available for the government? So these are the frameworks. If you remember this analogy, these are the frameworks. Citizen-centric, modern technology, right information, citizen charter, independent evaluation of services, grievance redressal, active citizen partnership. So this is the next line of your syllabus copy, right? Probity in governance. Yes, I hope it makes sense. So we have flown from ethical governance to governance and then tools of governance. So our primary focus for UPSC, sorry, ethics paper point of view will be on politician and bureaucrat. But in GS paper 2 point of view, you can throw in everyone. Bureaucrat, politician, judiciary, civil society, citizen, media. This is GS paper 2 point of view. This is GS paper 4 point of view. Mostly we will keep blaming politicians and the bureaucrats and how to make them efficient and better because they are the ones who deliver the governance. So and ethics case studies are always rotated in and around these two people, right? Most of the times. Occasionally civil society is also roped in. Clear? And also one major distinction in GS paper 2 and GS paper 4 is in GS paper 2, mostly we focus on the framework. What are the tools to improve good governance, governance, e-governance, what are the examples, etc. In GS paper 4, we will work on virtues or values plus framework. Both go hand in hand. But focus or at least keywords will be in orientation towards values. Any doubts? Okay, then I will share the PDF. Just keep reading the PDF. And the most important thing, I will repeat myself one more time. Ethics theory is easy. Examples are what you need to find on newspapers. Can we bring constitution articles in ethics? Yes, sometimes you can definitely bring them. For example, wherever there is a support system, definitely. For example, if you are criticizing the bureaucratic lethargy or red tapeism is reinforced by Article 311, you can write, because of Article 311 protection, bureaucracy has become indifferent. For example, in this line, indifferent attitude of the public servants is one of the reasons for this is Article 311, which protects the public servants. The instrument has become an institution. One more time. It is there to protect the honest bureaucrat from the political influence. But unfortunate outcome is lethargy, inefficiency, carelessness, lack of empathy, etc., etc. Right. Okay, then I will share the PDF. See you all tomorrow.